Thank you. Thank you, the organizers, first for inviting me and for giving me the opportunity to present my research here. I have to confess that I decided to go for a very risky talk. So I am presenting very new results. It's the first time that I am presenting this in a talk unpublished, and you realized by the type of title that I selected, the turbulent brain, that is a little bit provocative, but I am very enthusiastic with the results and with the framework, and therefore I wanted to talk about that and discuss this with you. So let me see if I go, yeah. So the idea is following. I mean, the motivation is try to see if we can use the theoretical framework of turbulence that was defined in the context of fluid dynamics in physics, as you know, and to see if some concepts can be used for complementing our vision of the spatial-temporal dynamics of the brain. And of course, as a secondary goal, if the brain dynamics shows some traces of turbulence and why or in which sense turbulence would be helpful for processing information. As you know, the word turbulence was, okay, so of course from Latin, like most of the words, but was introduced by Leonardo da Vinci in the context of fluid dynamics, took the word turbulence in Italian, coming from turba in Latin, meaning crowd, and he associated this crowd as a way of describing the irregularities in the spatial-temporal dynamic associated with fluid dynamic, with the formation of eddies in water, for example, when you pour a flow of water on some static water. I will mainly use, of course, two key concepts in the development of the theory of turbulence. One came very late in the 40s, last century, and it's associated with Andrei Kolmogorov, that decided that formulated what he called it a phenomenological theory of turbulence. And the second key concept that I will use is the ideas of Kuramoto that described turbulence in the context of couplet oscillators. So not in the context of fluid dynamics, but in a context of a totally different dynamical system, which, as we will see, is much more associated with the brain dynamics. So one of the key, just to motivate the talk, one of the key concepts in the idea of Kolmogorov, of the phenomenological theory of turbulence, that he was very skeptical that we can understand too much if we just solve in a bottom-up, ab initio way, the Navier-Stokes equations. And therefore, he was more impressed by the formation and by the dynamics of the vortices that seems to define a cascade of information or a cascade of transmission of energy. And therefore, he decided to formulate a phenomenological, or I would say, a statistical theory for trying to describe turbulence or the irregularities of these spatial-temporal dynamics at that level and not from the ab initio level of the underlying Navier-Stokes equations. He was basically motivated by this idea that was shown in the movie before and was introduced by Richardson, that he observed that the vortices in the typical turbulent regime of a fluid, they seem to form a cascade. So the largest vortex are interacting with the middle vortex with the smaller vortex. And he associated that intuitively with the cascade of energy transfer. And the regime where that works is called the inertial subrange. And that was the starting point of the phenomenological theory of Kolmogorov. He had a key idea, a key concept, which is called, funny enough, for people working in neuroscience, the concept is called structure functions. It has nothing to do with what we call a structure and what we call function in neuroscience, but it's just basically these very simple for equations where R is the distance between different points, in our case, in the Euclidean space. And it's basically, for example, the second order structure, this quadratic difference between the activity, generally is the velocity, in our case will be the the functional activity will use fMRI data, so it will be bold activity, and it's the difference between activity as a function of the distance. And it's very easy then it says to decompose this, and the basic element underlying this structure function is just the functional connectivity, but not in the usual way as we are most of the time observing functional connectivity in neuroimaging, but as a function again of this distance between the points that I am observing. So this is the key idea of the Kolmogorov theorem. He was able to show analytically and empirically in many different cases, in the context of fluid dynamics, of course, and in the context of the Navier-Stokes equation, that there is a regime that was this sub-inertial regime where we see a kind of power law in the structure function or in the associated per correlation function in all different orders with very typical slope, which is universal. And it's associated again with the cascade of the energy transfer in the same region, which also show a power law. So the idea is, and what I will try to show is first to see if we have traces of turbulence in brain dynamics when we observe now no fluid dynamic, but we observe the functional activity of the whole brain in terms of neuroimaging data, and see if we detect a kind of inertial subrange where some information cascades could be associated with the underlying power law. In the second step, I will try to go more into the deep and try to find some mechanistic explanation of the presence of those powers law. And I will do this using whole brain models, in particular whole brain models based on Stuart Landau oscillators, or the Hopf model. And at the end, I will discuss in which sense really we are observing not only traces of turbulence, but the brain dynamic is truly turbulent and how we can interpret that. So let's start with the first point, finding traces of turbulence. As I said, I will use neuroimaging data. In particular, I decided to go for the human connectome projects, where we have a very large number of subjects with the very well characterized are resting state conditions, relatively long time, with a very good tier of the scanners. So there are 1,003 participants that we analyze it under that particular condition. And we have structural information, and of course we have, but it's more interesting for us, bold functional information. And in fact, I mean, that was the cartoon that I was showing before, associated with the fluid dynamics. In fact, when we calculate the structure functions or the associated per correlation function as a function of the distance between the points that we are computing, we see that there are a trace of a power law in both cases, which is of course in the restricted range, which is around from millimeters to couple of centimeters. But seems to suggest that there are a cascade of information. In order to try to understand that from the mechanistic point of view, as I said, we will use a Hopf model. The idea is following that we will use one anatomical fact that was described in very careful studies in the lab of Henry Kennedy during the last decades with tracing studies in monkeys. And they discovered that the anatomy, so the structural information, fulfill an exponential decaying law. And this is the so-called exponential Markov Kennedy decay distance rule. So associated, you have a probability of having a relatively strong anatomical connection in the short distance, and the farther you go in the Euclidean distance, then this information decays. Of course, you have exceptions to that, which are the long-range connections, which are not described here. So in the context of the model, we use the general idea of whole brain models that were introduced also during the last decades by many different labs. The idea is to use the underlying anatomical connectivity, usually DTI. In this case, we use both. We will use sometimes the DTI that we have in the context of the HCP data set, or we use the explicit decay distance rule of Markov Kennedy. On top of that, we associate to each node an Stuart Landau oscillator or Hopf model. And then we study for difference working point, which is basically associated with the coupling parameter underlying those interactions between the oscillators, how the whole brain dynamics is influenced. And in particular here, we study that in terms of the structure functions introduced by Kolmogorov. By the way, I forgot to say, I mean, we use a relatively fine parcellation. It's the so-called Scheffer parcellation, which is defined by 1,000 nodes across the cortex. For the moment, we ignore the subcortex. So these are the first results where we see the lambda associated with the decay of the underlying anatomical distance rule of Markov Kennedy, the coupling parameter, and what we see here is the level of fitting of the structure function, actually the pair correlation as a function of R. And what we see is that first, that there are a very particular regions, actually the best working point is around here, where we can explain very well the data, suggesting that because the underlying anatomy is homogeneous and isotropic by definition of the Markov Kennedy rule, also at the functional level we get an isotropic and homogeneous core, which show the power law in terms of the structure function associated with the concept of Kolmogorov. We can address the optimal point, and this is now if we go and do the simulation for that particular point in the sub-inertial range, we see the comparisons between the model and the empirical data associated with those 1,000 different participants, and we can see that we can describe pretty well the evolution of the structure function of the pair correlation as a function of the distance R, and also associated with the power law. At last, what we do is we go a little bit more into the details, and we were inspired by a particular idea introduced by Kuramoto, where he studied also Stuart Landau oscillators in a 1D ring. And basically, he introduced not only the nearest neighbor interaction, which is typical in the Ginzburg-Landau equation, but he studied what he called the non-locally coupled oscillators. So basically, they have this neighborhood relationship, and is weighted by a function g, and this function g, by casuality, is exactly like the Markov-Kennedy distance rule. In this context, he studied turbulence, and he defined a local version of the Kuramoto order parameter. As you know, the Kuramoto order parameter is just the sum of the exponential of the imaginary part of the phases, and basically the module of that, which is R, is the label of synchronization. But if you extend that and you weight now these exponents with the corresponding weighting function, then you have for each point a kind of local synchronization, which in turn is turbulence could be interpreted as a kind of local level of entropy or local vortex. And in fact, he studied different aspects of turbulence, like amplitude turbulence and phase turbulence. I will only focus now here on amplitude turbulence, which is basically associated with the level of metastability of those local parameters. So therefore, it's a kind of metastability of the measured in terms of those local Kuramoto order parameters. So the larger is that level of that variability, and this is the simulation for the ring, space and time of the Kuramoto paper, then when you have a large value, then you can say that you have amplitude turbulence. In fact, here, in order to simplify and just to study one parameter, remember that until now we had two parameters, the lambda measuring the decaying of the underlying anatomy and the coupling, the level of interactions between the different local neuronal models, in our case, Stuart lambda oscillators. Now, in order to simplify, we just took the underlying DTI tractography, meaning the underlying anatomy measured on the same subjects where we have the functionality information, and we fit basically with an exponential function the distance rule of Markov Kennedy, and we fix the lambda with that fitting. So in that sense, then we know the lambda, which, by the way, of course, was very much related with the original lambda that we found in the other simulation. But now we fix that, and we have now only one parameter, which is this G parameter, which is the global coupling parameter. So here, what we see in blue is the level of fitting, as before. Basically, for different setting of that parameter, we could have a very bad fitting, or we have actually a working point where the empirical data are relatively well fitted, as before. But now the new thing and the important aspect is really to see this, this red curve, which is expressing the level of metastability of the local Kuramoto order parameter, meaning it's associated with what we call, what Kuramoto call amplitude turbulence. And what we see is that at that particular point seems to be that the level of turbulence is maximal, which is pretty nice. So meaning that the working point fitting the data correspond to the point where we observe maximal turbulence, suggesting that the brain is working at the point with maximal turbulence. The question is why, and we can discuss later on. This is another simulation showing exactly the same fitting of the empirical data as before with the working point, but now the goodness of fitting of the power law in the sub-inertial range, and we see that from here on we start to have a relatively good fitting, so that the power law is getting better and better. The next two studies, we define the susceptibility and a generalization of susceptibility, which we call information capability. So basically, we perturb the system and we see how the system reacts in terms of that perturbation. And in one case, we do this as in statistical physics with a constant perturbation, or we vary the perturbation and we see how this difference variation of the perturbation is reflected in the variation of what we measure, which is exactly the metastability of the local Kuramoto parameter. And what we see is that here again seems to be that the information capability, so the way how we reflect external perturbations, in other words, the way how we encode external information in the system is maximal exactly at the point where we had maximal turbulence and where we have also a maximal fitting to the empirical data. Another aspect is anecdotic, so I will not discuss this too much. We can, of course, also describe the brain dynamics, the functional brain dynamic in terms of segregation and integration, was introduced in the literature, topological aspect of the functional dynamics. And again, we see a good balance, an optimal balance between segregation and integration. It's a little bit shifted from the optimal working point, but meaning that also that particular point where we have maximal turbulence, we have all those nice properties of the system. In fact, what we see here is in both, well, we cannot see the reality for some reason, it's not working. On the left, I mean, would be the level of turbulence. So it's the local Kuramoto order parameter across the time for the different position in the rendering of the brain, and the same for the model at the optimal working point. Actually, it's a pity that it's not working, but they look extremely similar. So what you see here is exactly what you see here. So that the general level of metastability looks extremely similar. So conclusions, using these concepts from the theory of Kolmogorov, the phenomenological theory of Kolmogorov, mainly the structure of functions idea, we discovered that there are traces of turbulences in terms of a power law, suggesting a cascade of information, probably in terms of correlations. And we were able to explain that mechanistically, hypothesizing that the origin of that turbulence and of that power law is associated with the underlying anatomy, coupling the different nonlinear oscillators, in our case, such as Hopf oscillators. And we see that this isotropy and homogeneity defined in the context of anatomy is also present. By the way, that was defined in the context of monkey anatomy. So I think it's the first time that we see traces of that anatomy also at the level of TTI, of real human anatomy. And what is more important for us in our context is to associate that with the emergence of isotropy and homogeneity also at the functional level, and showing those traces of turbulence, in particular of amplitude turbulence. The second main take-home message, I think, is that it's not only that we have turbulence and we can explain that mechanistically, but it seems to be that the working point where the human brain decided to work is a point of maximal turbulence. And probably this is associated with the fact that at that particular point, we have a very effective transmission of information across the different spatial scales and a very effective encoding of information that we try to describe coarsely and with the proxies of susceptibility and information capability. Just to finish, I mean, and to suggest some challenging question, I mean, it's very astonishing that the Stuart Landau is so universal. As you know, it's the most simple nonlinear generalization of an oscillator and was really used in all possible contexts in physics, all different type of system. Basically, as you know, even in the seminal book of Kuramoto, was the main idea of trying to show how those nonlinear Hopf, Stuart Landau oscillators are able to express really a variety of phenomena, in particular also fluid dynamics. And we use it, of course, and we can generalize that, and that was also done by Kuramoto. And if you define just a very simple coupling of nearest neighbors, and you observe the continuous definition of that dynamics, what you get is the Gibbs-Bohr-Landau, which I would say is one of the most celebrated equations in physics. And then Kuramoto came again with a genial idea, introducing this non-local coupling, particularly the exponential decay associated with the by casuality, by the way, with the anatomical Markov Kennedy distance rule. And now I think, and that is the challenging point for the future, we have to study a system where we have not only this non-linear, non-local coupling in terms of the Kennedy rule, but on top of that, we have the exceptions. And there are not so many exceptions. I calculated that in the same database of 1,000 people of the HDP, there are around 3-4% exceptions. So it's relatively a teeny number, but those exceptions, which are long-range coupling, are probably fundamental. And therefore, that is a unique system, so far as I know, but you can correct me, where we have this difference, so the nearest neighbor in the style of Ginzburg-Landau, the non-linear, the non-local coupling in terms of the exponential decay, and on top of that, the exceptions. And probably those exceptions make the processing of the brain even more interesting, but future questions. So I think I am done, so I am ready for answering questions if I have time.
Thanks very much for a great talk and for sticking to time. We've got some time for questions. So the first question here comes from Kuba Orvosky, who says, you say that the operating point of the brain is at maximum turbulence. Would you say that this is related to the critical brain hypothesis?
Which hypothesis, sorry?
The critical brain hypothesis.
Yeah, that is an excellent question. Definitely yes, and it's not an intuition or a speculation. We have another model after that, because we have exactly the same the same intuition, and we analyze this with a spin glass model where we can study rigorously criticality, and it's turned out that with the same data, the 1,000 HCP participants, we demonstrated that the working point is exactly at the point where the susceptibility diverges, so it's a criticality point. So pretty sure that this is they are corresponding. Why, we don't know. They are concomitant.
Okay, great. So next question is from Tony Guleman, who says, why do you choose a hop-like model for the nodes? Are you assuming that this onset of oscillations is generic or more ubiquitous in brain nodes? Do you expect the maximal turbulence properties to be maintained with different onset oscillators, e.g. a SNC?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I can answer why I took the Hopf oscillators. And this is because we used this type of model before. We introduced that in 2017. And in order just to describe normal whole brain dynamics or functional connectivity dynamics, and many different aspects. And in fact, I mean, so far as I know, the best working model in terms of fitting the data is the Hopf model. And probably my intuition is because it's a little bit more flexible than the Kuramoto model, so that the rigid oscillators, because you could have the possibility to have oscillation or no oscillations, or a mixture between oscillations and noise. In fact, I mean, the best working point we have shown is at the bifurcation point of the Stewart-Landau. So meaning that we have a genuine mixture of behavior. Yeah, that is what I can, to the second part, I cannot say anything. Sorry, Tony.
So we'll take one more question, which is from Andre Longton, who says, thanks for a beautiful talk, Gustavo. How close to the Hopf boundary do these Stewart-Landau oscillators need to be?
Yeah.
To be tuned, the G optimum you showed seems quite broad.
Yeah. Yeah, that is what I said. Thank you, by the way. What I have just said, I mean, because we have this experience and we studied this before, not in the context of the context of turbulence, but in the context of just normal functional connectivity studies, we saw that the best working point is exactly at the bifurcation point of the Stewart-Landau. So basically, the local bifurcation parameter is practically zero. It's a little bit on the noisy. But it's a super critical, by the way, Hopf bifurcation. And therefore I took in this case exactly that point. What we are doing now is we are trying to introduce heterogeneity that introduces also variability around that critical point of the local bifurcation parameter. And that seems to improve the level of fitting.
Okay. Thanks very much. And there is another question in the Q&A if you have time to type out an answer.
Yeah, sure.
For the next talk. And I also should have mentioned that you can upvote questions. So if you see someone else's question that you think you'd like answered, please upvote it for the next talk.